Well, thanks, Stephanie, for having been the Lord here, as along with all of you, fine people, for coming. One of the sort of central tenets of this conference, of the spirit of this conference, is that money is fundamentally political. But so is the American presidency. And the American presidency is a little strange right now, and I really wanted to get your perspective on the Donald Trump phenomenon before we get into technical details about money, numbers, and what it's like.
Well, I've been having an ongoing discussion with Jamie Gilbreth, I don't know whether Jamie's here, about the significance of the Trump victory, and I think his view is that there's nothing very important about it, that other than, given America's constitutional setup, any Republican would have won, given the trends in population and things of that kind. And that in fact, not only did Trump win fewer votes than Hillary, but also a smaller share of popular vote than Mitt Romney had done. And so, in a way, there's nothing to explain. I find that incomplete. I think his victory is a significant phenomenon because I think it links up with a whole lot of other populist manifestations in Europe as well. I think there is some symbolism. There was an interesting article by Edward Luttwak in the Times Literary Supplement a few weeks ago, and the title was something like "Why the Trump Dynasty is Going to Last 16 Years." And I think his basic argument had to do with car ownership, not with home owner. He said, you know, the medium American household can no longer afford a new car, and that is something unprecedented in the last 30 years, and that's enough to fuel resentment. And I mistrust monarchy's explanation, but broadly speaking, there is something that needs explaining. There must, I think, be some element of, you know, putting it this way, peasants' revolt against elites going on, not just in the United States, but in Europe as a whole.
And so, in the United States, there's a significant debate within the Democratic Party, oddly, about whether or not economic factors have any significance at all in the rise of Trump. When we talk about a peasant's revolt, what sort of factors are we talking about?
Well, you know, Ms. Clinton said the economy is stupid. And, well, broadly speaking, a whole lot of people have lost out from the current, not only the financial crisis, but the whole way globalization has evolved in the last 20 years. And that is reflected in actual data. I mean, median incomes have either stagnated or fallen in most rural regions, in most Western countries in the last 20 years. So there is a large swathe of people who feel the system is screwing them somewhere or other. And they don't quite know what it is that's screwing them, but they do know what sort of people have been in power over this period. And if given the chance, they will express that resentment. I think it's sort of, in Europe, it's nationalist, it's anti-immigrant, it's protectionist. It is, in fact, rather like fascism. But I don't think we should think in terms of a direct imitation of the specific forms fascism took in the 1930s. But generically, it comes, I think, out of the same set of resentments and probably the same sort of people who vote for these parties. And in America, a populist has won office. In Europe, that hasn't been true. Some of the elected leaders turn populist in office, particularly Orban in Hungary and the Polish leaders. But I mean, a big indication is Brexit, the rise of UKIP in Britain. And Nigel Farage got 4 million votes in 2010. And that, it was fear that led David Cameron in 2015 promised a referendum on the European Union. So he won the election and lost Britain membership of the European Union.
Well, can you tell us about Jeremy Corbyn and see what he's the most recent
case? Jeremy Corbyn is another strand. After all, Jeremy Corbyn comes out of another kind of set of resentments, and I think one saw some of the roots of them in the Seattle demonstrations against the WTO in 1999, and then against the World Bank and the IMF in Prague the following year. This is a left-wing reaction to globalization on the neoliberal model. And I think Jeremy Corbyn comes there, but what is evident is that he has moved the Labour Party quite a lot to the left. He's attracted a lot of support from young people, people who didn't really want to vote in the past, but have been enthused by it. And if one wants to talk frankly, I don't think he's a very wonderful leader. I don't think he's particularly charismatic. He seems to be sincere. People close to him say he's not very intelligent. Is that a defect in a leader or an advantage? It is something.
So we'll have to find out in the United States.
But no, he's also a symptom of the time, as was the very strong showing of the left-wing candidate in France, and a very strong showing of Bernie Sanders in the States. So it's not just one way. There's a populism of the right and the populism of the left. But they overlap in some of their programs. And one, the most important area overlap is in the running of the economy, the programs for securing a better economy.
So this conference is organized around, I think, at least one tradition coming out of the thought of John Maynard Keynes. And I think when most people think about Keynes, they think about the general theory. I certainly did before I read your wonderful two-volume biography. Some of the most interesting material in that biography is the period of his life between the two world wars, leading up to World War II in particular. He has a lot of things to say about the global economy as it's sort of deteriorating and going off the cliff. Are there any particular writings from say the 1920s or the early 1930s that you think are relevant to this particular moment?
I mean, apart from Keynes. It was a period of enormous ferment in monetary theory. And Keynes, who starts life as a monetary theorist as a critic of the gold standard. And in that he wasn't at all unique. He was part of a group of monetary reformers. The most famous in the United States is Irving Fisher, but I think you must include Wicksell, the Swedish economist. And they were all concerned about the economic cost of business cycles, or what they called credit cycles at the time. And the fact that, you know, with every, as Fisher said, with every movement of prices up or down, millions of people, you know, get thrown onto the scrap heap. And Wicksell said exactly the same thing. So it was really what they were after was to get more stability in the price level by cutting the connection between the quantity of money in an economy and the quantity of credit and the gold standard. The gold standard was a very erratic government. said you're against the gold standard, but then you wire the monetary reformer because you want to put the control of monetary policy into the hands of a central bank. And the central bank, using the quantity theory of money, should be able to control the quantity of money and therefore the price level. I mean, it is as simple as that. And so they wrote out the equations and then tried to apply. Now, Keynes comes out of this tradition. And the tract on monetary reform is exactly a monetary reformer tract. He says, look, the gold standard, he calls it a barbarous relic. We've got to cut our link with it, entrust monetary policy to the scientific management of the experts in the central bank. And he basically had the same idea in the treatise on money. And he had very exalted hopes for what he called scientific management of the monetary system. He said, at last, we the elements of the science are beyond dispute. This was very much a standard phrase of the monetary reformers. I just wanted to quote one thing he says in the treatise on money, if I can find it. Whenever I'm looking for anything to quote, I never manage to quote, but I have in this case. And this is from a treatise on money. A central bank, which is free to govern the volume of cash and reserve money in its monetary system by the joint use of bank rate and open market operations, is in a position to control not merely the volume of credit, but the rate of investment, the level of prices, and in the long run, the level of incomes, provided that the objective it sets before itself is compatible with its legal obligations, such as those relating to gold convertibility or the parity of the foreign exchanges. So, provided it was free from the fixed exchange rate commitment, then the central bank could determine the volume of activity in the economy. So that was the dream. And in the 1920s, I think, the monetary reformers were greatly encouraged by what the Fed was able to do in the United States. Because the Fed exactly used this kind of theory to manage its interest rate policy and its open market operations policy. And why was it able to try that? Because there was no gold constraint, really, in the United States. It was running such large surpluses, it was just accumulating gold. What it was doing was sterilizing gold. But then it was free to run a monetary policy along the lines which the monetary reformers were urging, in a way that Britain wasn't, or any other country on the gold standard. So, you know, that was the vindication of the monetary reform movement, and then triumph turned to ashes in 1929, when the American economy collapsed, and the Fed was not able to do anything about it. And out of that grew a narrative, which of course was Milton Friedman's, that mistakes in its monetary management prevented the Fed from maintaining the money supply, and therefore allowed a collapse in the money supply, and therefore brought about a much deeper depression than would otherwise have occurred.
And so Milton Friedman then becomes a major figure about 50 years later. What does he have to say in the 1970s that's different from what Keynes and the monetary reformers were saying in the 20s?
Well, by that time, Keynes had abandoned program of the monetary reformers in the general theory, but Friedman was heir to it. And not only was Friedman heir to it, but Bernanke was heir to it, and Mervyn King, was the governor of the Bank of England, was heir to it. So they were determined this time round not to repeat the mistakes of the Fed in 1929-30, and to actually pump a lot of money into the economy.
Is it fair to say that Milton Friedman is like the ultimate bastard Keynesianism?
The ultimate what?
The bastard Keynesian.
Well, I don't think he would have thought of himself as a... Well, you see, he was very... Either as a bastard or as a Keynesian. But, you know, but in a way, he was a Keynesian. In the sense he was a Keynesian in that he worked within a macroeconomic framework, the ISLM framework, which was common to all economies. I had a kind of long correspondence with Milton Friedman when I was writing the second volume of my book, and I went up to see him in his home in California. He drove up from the Hoover Institution. He was a fellow there, and I went up and I spent the day with him. He was late 80s, I guess, by then. I said, have you been playing tennis? Because that was the thing he always did. He said, I always play tennis. Now, I haven't been playing tennis today. I've kept myself free to discuss the great matters we're going to talk about. And I said, what's your view of Keynes? And he said, he was one of the great economists of the profession. He asked the right questions for the time he was living in. The questions have changed. And what's more, he asked English questions and not American questions. I mean, that was the other thing that he said. He said, had Keynes grown up in the United States, he would have realized how corrupt government was. And he wouldn't have placed his faith in the state. But growing up in England, in an aristocratic society where, you know, governments were run by these civilized and, you know, clever people, you didn't have to worry about democracy, then it seemed that, you know, the state was the last resort. It's the last lender, the last employer, and so on. And Friedman said, well, you know, American experience has taught us otherwise. So Friedman would have been in the family of Keynes in some way, in a way that Robert Lucas and the Rational Expectations people wouldn't have been.
So there's some other activity that happened in the 1970s outside of the monetarists, particularly in the Keynesian tradition. The tradition really transforms in the 1970s. Do you have thoughts on what happens to the sort of inter-Keynesian fights during that decade?
Someone's got to really do a proper history of what went wrong in the 1970s. Because that was a watershed. And a particular narrative was then created by Friedman on the back of a lot of work he had done in undermining bits and pieces of the neoclassical synthesis before that. But the narrative was the crisis was due to the attempts of Keynesian government to keep the rate of unemployment below its natural rate, and therefore that meant that they were pumping money into the economy, and then expectations were being adapted to this, and so the policy gradually became ineffectual in its effect on real activity, but only then started to affect the price level alone. So, I mean, that was where the Keynesian revolution went wrong. It went wrong because it had a commitment to full employment. And once you had that commitment, which was settled by reference to past levels of full employment achieved, so that the commitment gradually became 1-2% in the United Kingdom and 4% in the United States. Once you had that backward-looking kind of commitment, you were really sunk. If you went on without changing, your policy objective. And I don't think that was really it, because if you think of what went wrong in the 1970s, I don't think you can blame it on Keynesianism. I think, like most things that go wrong in the world, as well as many things that they're right, it was the United States. It was the United States overspending in order to support different spending programs, one of the chief of which was the Vietnam War. And the inability of the American Constitution, the way the budget process worked, for the administration to raise taxes, partly to finance that. And the Keynesians, you know, who were giving advice, were advising Johnson to raise taxes long before a rather inadequate tax hike was agreed. And then through the dollar exchange system, America was able generate inflation in other countries. So that's one. Now, is that a failure of Keynesian policy? I don't know that it is. So you had a conjuncture. Then, of course, you had the collapse. You had the oil price crisis. You had the abandonment of the fixed exchange rate. The Bretton Woods system collapsed at the same time. Then you had mistakes in European countries. I mean, basically, credit just exploded in Britain after the fixed exchange rate, after the dollar exchange rate collapse. So I think there were lots of things that go wrong, lots of mistakes that were being made, but I don't think of them as systemic mistakes arising from a resolute pursuit of Keynesian policy objectives. I think those mistakes might have been made by other regimes faced with this set of events. But as I said, I've never read a very, very good historical account of that. And where Friedman is completely wrong, it seems to me, is that there wasn't a build-up of inflation over the whole Keynesian period. If you look at the figures, the inflation really started to get troublesome from 1967, 1968 onwards. Before then, it was fairly stable, a little bit higher than in previous decades, but not significantly. And so you had full employment, you had a fairly stable rate of inflation, you had a fast rate of growth, and you had absolute unprecedented period of prosperity. Now, I don't think that's all due to Keynes. Then I don't think you can blame Keynes, you know, for things that went wrong in the period 68 to 75.
Yeah, one of the things in Friedman's thought that was always interesting is the language that he uses, like the natural rate of unemployment. If there's a certain level where you're supposed to have a certain number of people jobless, but the economic profession doesn't want free trade. We want to be free, everybody, so let's have free trade. But what free trade is changes from 1912 to 2012. You mentioned globalization and Donald Trump earlier. What would Keynes have to say about the current global trading regime?
Well, he was very, very clear. He was, if you want to relate him to a modern theorist, he was a Danny Rockwell kind of globalist. I mean, in other words, he said that a global trading system has to be embedded in some institutions of global governments. Otherwise, it's going to break down. You're not going to be able to do it on a neoliberal basis. And that's why he was so keen on setting up these institutions in the 1940s. He didn't get his own way because America held most of the cards. And America was not prepared for an international clearing agreement, which would aim to achieve zero balances on trade, on trade over a year. So he couldn't get that. So there was no real barrier in the Bretton Woods system to countries accumulating reserves. But nevertheless, it was a potential, and there was a World Bank, and there was a sort of trading agreement, which, you know, took time to get going. But there was this set of institutions. And basically, the neoliberal dispensation set about emasculating all these institutions. And so you can look at globalization as an attempt to escape from national regulations, which was sort of fixed to some extent. If you could get an economy going outside the national regulatory system, you were going to achieve some goal of realizing the free market idea. So I don't think globalization was irreversible, is irreversible. I think it was a political project, and it should be chained up in some way. Now, I think as a historian, and historians here will understand, know this, that globalization was at its peak in 1914, the first wave of globalization, when levels of integration of the major economies were greater than was ever achieved again until the 1990s. And then, of course, it collapsed. So it has been reversed, and it was reversed because, in the end, it set up too many strains and stresses. A great free trader, Lionel Robbins, wrote in 1960 that the fault of free traders is that they believe that you can do it without a government. They don't believe you don't have to have a government within a country, but they think you don't have to have any world government or anything like a world government in order to have a free market system going, because they believe in some ideal equilibrium that and you read some of these free trade arguments. Incidentally, no country in the world has ever been free trade, except maybe Britain, for a short time in the 19th century. And they've always been mercantilists. They've always really tried to protect their industries that they regarded as vital in one way or another. But still, in the 19th century, Britain was free trade. And if you look at the free trade arguments, you understand that they're long-run arguments, and therefore they're going to be losers and winners, are arguments which create, often lead to big developing inequalities of income, and all these things are just assumed to sort of wash out in the long run in to the general advantage of all. But when there are breakages on the way, you have to have some authority to protect people against them and to compensate for them, and they simply ignore.
You see in a lot of Keynes' writing, he's dealing explicitly with the connection between the financial system and the trading system. It seems like, at least in my lifetime, the two defining political events have been a breakdown in both the trading system and the financial system. I mean, how did we do with the financial crisis? Were the responses on either side of the Atlantic appropriate or sufficient?
Well, I think that's well put. I mean, Keynes wanted to set up a payment system which would make free trade, freedom of trade, possible. That was the point. That was the point of Bretton Woods. So we don't have that now. Look, capital controls are an integral part of the Bretton Woods system. Keynes never believed you could run a free trade system and have capital mobility at the same time. He thought capital mobility would cause the free trade system to break down. And indeed, we've tried to create a trinity which defines what a global free market is, which is freedom of movement, freedom of goods, freedom of capital, and freedom of people to move. And we've tried to arrange all that without anything like political counterparts in the global economy to regulate it. And of course, that's not going to work. The European Union is a very big, it's probably gone furthest in all the regions in economic integration. And of course, the nationalism that you see in the European Union is a direct reaction to free labour movement. So I think the project was utopian. It was also very dangerous. I mean, we play with fire if we attempt to set up a system with so few controls on movement of capital as this system. So Keynes believed in capital controls. He actually wanted to restrict the role of the banks in the allocation of capital to developing countries. He thought that most of development capital would be supplied via the World Bank or through or on a concessionary basis. He didn't believe that the banks should actually take on the major part of financing development, because he was too much alive to the possibility of capital flood. And that, of course, happened in 1997-1998.
It's interesting how much he is involved in the World Bank at the Bretton Woods Conference, how much stock he puts in that institution. It seems very clear in retrospect that of the two institutions, it's much weaker. Do you think he would have been surprised by the role that both those institutions played and then what became of the World Bank?
Yeah, well, you see, the Americans were much more interested in the IMF than the World Bank. They knew Keynes had to chair some committees, so they put him on the World Bank, because they weren't interested in what happened in the World Bank, really. What they were interested in was getting an IMF going that didn't make too many, that didn't make America pay for others' profligacy, just provided emergency finance. And the American view of the IMF is very much the same as Germany's view of its obligations in the European Union today. Emergency finance on quite strict terms, whereas Keynes wanted more generous finance on much looser terms. And so the Americans were determined to keep him away from the IMF, so they put him in charge of the World Bank. And there everything went quite smoothly, although Keynes was an extremely bad chairman, everyone said, at the World Bank. He was very, very impatient. He went through the agenda at lightning speed before people, delegates are very loquacious at these events. Keynes kept cutting them off and going on to the next item of business. He was very sick at the time. So one felt he was battling against his own mortality in trying to get these things through. The World Bank, the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, was supposed to have enough funding to finance not only development but reconstruction. That's why it was cool. That's why it got its title. But it never got enough capital to do that. And therefore, the actual reconstruction funds for the reconstruction of Europe were provided by the United States through Marshall Aid. Whereas Keynes had wanted to internationalize all lending functions precisely to avoid one country being able to dominate the conditions on which the loans were made. But of course he failed to do that because he didn't have the clout. Britain didn't have the clout any longer. Nevertheless, the lesson you learn from this is that if you want to reform the international monetary system, you have to have agreement among two or three countries, and then everything else will follow. And the countries involved now are the United States, China, and Germany, essentially.
And you mentioned Germany a couple of times now. I mean, what do you think of Germany's role in managing the European monetary system since the crash?
Well, it's, on the whole, I think Germany's role has been Germany is quite a benevolent master of Europe, you want to put it that, but the Germans won't allow you to use that phrase, leader, hegemon, because they believe any suggestion of German leading this pact will remind people of Hitler, and therefore it's absolutely verboten to talk about German leadership. But if you can't talk about German leadership, you can't talk about Germany's responsibilities. So that discussion is cut off at the root. you might say, look, hegemon, in terms Pindleberger has made familiar, has certain has to provide certain incentives for countries to follow the rules of the system. And those are often at the sacrifice, you know, the responsibility comes with sacrifice. So you can't have that kind of discussion in Germany. They just say, look, we're one among many, we're successful, it's up to others to be more like us, and then they'll be successful. That's as far as it really gets. Of course, we can provide some emergency finance, but it's got to be well collateralized, and it can come with other conditions. And so, if you're a cynic, you can say, look, this is a German plot to buy up the whole of the Mediterranean. They just acquire more and more assets in return for financing. So you can take that view. So in the end, Germany will own most of the assets of the southern flank of the European Union. I think Germans don't think of it in that way. Of course not. It's just simply, you know, what a success, what a country should do. And as for the Greeks, if only they were more like Germans, then things would be fine. And you'd get a natural balancing of these surpluses and deficits. And the trouble is, lots of Greeks agree with them, actually. It is the conservative Greeks who agree with them. They feel ashamed at not being more like the Germans. And anyway, that's part of the dynamics of the
European Union. When you talk to people in the United States, like the Obama administration, for instance, about the European situation, you can tell they do not approve of essentially the austerity packages that keep being forced on Greece again and again. But they also were very reluctant to do anything about it. And they say, well, if we put pressure on Germany, we need them for help with Russia, and that's sort of the end of the story. Does the United States have some role to play in the global financial system as a leader, particularly after the American role in the financial crisis?
Yeah, well, I'm struck by two things. That both the Great Depression and the Great Recession were made in the United States. In the first instance by the collapse of the American stock market in October 1929, and then in the later case through the collapse of the mortgage retail house property sector. And they were then transmitted by a series of international linkages to the rest of the system. So why is America the source, the great source of instability in the world economic system? It's the source of great strength and growth, but also great instability. They both seem to be somehow located or centered in the United States. As for the American reaction to the Great Recession, I think America. I mean, in one phrase, there was less austerity and more expansion, more stimulus in the American reaction. That's why the Americans recovered better than the Europeans. There was nothing in Europe like those two programs, the TARP program and then the stimulus program. $1.5 trillion, you know, injected. There was nothing like that in Europe. So I think the results are exactly what Keynes would have predicted, that you had faster recovery in the United States. On the other hand, and this is where I think, you know, modern monetary theory does have something to say, quantitative easing is a very weak tool for recovery. I think the fiscal expansion in the United States was actually more powerful than the monetary expansion. But in Europe, there was no fiscal expansion. After a little bit at the beginning, all the engines were reversed, and you went into austerity mode, and that undoubtedly slowed down, to my way of thinking, the European recovery. So I think America, I don't think America provided any real leadership in permanent reform of the system after in the last 10 years.
So Stephanie showed me these absolutely horrible videos online of people doing rap battles, performing as Keynes and Hayek in the 1930s. These are completely intolerable. But it is remarkable to me the way we sort of extract the politics of those two people from their economic theories. Both of them thought of themselves as sort of anti-authoritarians. I kind of wanted to talk to you, just get your view on who you think got the better part of the anti-authoritarian argument between the two of them, and really if there's anything from either of them that we can learn for today's situation.
Well, yeah, I was actually present when they made that rap of Keynes versus Hayek. I mean, they showed the rap everywhere, but not the comments I made.
Sorry, to trash your work.
Yeah, it was in two parts. And there was a Hayek film, and there was me, and we sort of argued it afterwards. But the rap was quite widely shown. Now, I think, is it a family dispute, looking back at it from a long distance, long perspective? Partly. Both of them had one common ancestor. And that was Vixen. And there's a fascinating essay by Axel Leijonhufvud, the Swedish economist, called The Vixen Connection, which goes, one of the strands goes to Hayek, and the other one goes to Keynes. Now, how could this be? Because there's yet a third strand that goes into a central bank modeling as it was practiced before the Great Recession. 2007-2008. So Vixell is an absolutely pivotal figure in 20th century monetary history, and yet he's the least known of the protagonists. And I think Vixell was the first person who stated very clearly, in modern terms, what became the credit theory of money. He was the first person to state very clearly the distinction between the natural rate of interest and the market rate of interest. So, there was, and therefore the need to keep the two in equilibrium. And so he was the first to state very clearly the whole savings investment problem. So there are many things that lead away from, lead from Vixell. But of course, he still clung to the classical dichotomy in some way. He was trying to bring, he was trying to abolish classical dichotomy. But he also kept, really, his reference point was always to the real economy and what would happen to the real economy if monetary policy was correctly conducted. They were separate in his own mind. Now, why did one strand lead to Hayek? Because Hayek fastened on the ability of the banks to create credit at will, and therefore excessive credit creation became the Hayek explanation for booms and busts. And that leads him, first of all, it leads him to a very, very strong defense of the gold standard as a limit to the credit creation of banks. But once the gold standard goes, it really leads him to an idea of competitive banking. He doesn't have any faith in central banks being able to control creation of credit.
Are there people here who are familiar with this phrase, competitive banking? People know about this?
They should just make their own currencies, and then in competition, the one with the best reputation would come out as the one being most used. That's really it.
It's the worst idea. Yeah.
Competitive issues of money. And that was his final. That was his final position. But of course, you see what Hayek was interested in always. Was in the problem of inflation. He wasn't interested in the problems of deflation. He comes out of Central Europe. He lives through the hyperinflation of the 19 to early 1920s. And he comes back into his own with the inflation of the 70s and 80s. And suddenly Hayek is there again, having been obliterated in the intervening period because no one was interested in the problems of inflation in 1930. And Hayek's remedy, I mean, Hayek's explanation for the Great Depression was that there was excessive credit creation going on in the United States economy, which was being financed by the Fed in its effort to keep stability, stable prices. Because if the Fed had actually pursued the correct policy, the price level should have been falling in the United States, not kept stable. So that was Hayek's definition of the inflation going on in the United States before the Great Depression, under the surface of price stability, because the price level wasn't moving, but according to Hayek, it should have been falling. So Hayek's focus was always on the problem of inflation and how to control it. Whereas by the time Keynes was coming to consider these problems, it was deflation that was the issue. And not too much credit being created by the banks, but too little credit being created by the banks, because the demand for credit was not there. So how does the government then has a role to play, and at first he thinks it's the central bank that should be playing that role, but by the early 30s he thinks that monetary policy is too weak. And as against the modern monetary theories, his view is not changed by the fact that there's no longer a fixed exchange rate and Britain is actually free has got monetary autonomy. And there is a quote here which I think is quite interesting. This is from 1933, where Keynes writes, "It may still be the case that the lender, with his confidence shattered by his experience, will continue to ask from new enterprises rates of interest which the borrower cannot expect to earn. If this proves to be the case, there will be no means of escape from prolonged and perhaps interminable depression, except by direct state intervention promote new investment." So he switched from a belief in monetary therapy to a belief in fiscal therapy, and that is reflected in the way the general theory is set out. So, anyway, this is a very tangled story with many threads, but they tend to start with Witzel, these entangling threads.
I want to talk to you about where the economics profession has gone since that period, because, I mean, say what you will about the Hayekians, they are at least, Hayek at least has ideas. And clearly, I mean, they're all wrong, but there are ideas there, and he's engaged in the battle of ideas with Keynes. And it seems to me today we have a whole bunch of people who are wrong and irrelevant with their heads in the sand, and then you have MMT. And that's about it for the battle of ideas with the economics profession. Views on this, obviously, but you know, how did the economic progression go from being this area where people were really willing to test different philosophies to something where people were sort of hiding in a corner with their mathematical models?
Well, again, yeah. What is it that causes ideas to win? The vote, so to speak, in intellectual terms, and lose it. Hayek. So two things about Hayek to say. First of all, he was I think. Let's say about his theory may, in a way, have had some merit to it, which is that you do have this process, and there is a credit cycle. Too much credit is being created, and unsustainable asset bubbles. And certainly that seems to be sort of something, seems to be what was going on in the United States pre-2007. But then his remedy is, of course, to allow the system to collapse entirely so that you can correct this misallocation of capital that's been happening. So, phrase Paul Davidson likes to quote from one of the US Secretary of the Treasury under Hoover. What was it called? Yeah, Andrew Mellon. Liquidate everything. Liquidate all the unsound things, and then you'll be able to sort of resume healthy growth. Now, politically, that's suicide, and everyone knows that. That's why no one's ever actually adopted Hayekian remedies for a crash once it's occurred. The other thing about the Hayekians is that they hold their beliefs very, very religiously. Now, I'm not sure that isn't true of all economists when they feel that they're a beleaguered minority. I think there's a religious element to economic belief. Historically, most economists were sons or grandsons of vicars and ministers of God, and they just transferred their allegiance from heavenly salvation to earthly salvation. So there's a sort of kind of religious thread that runs through economics, which belies a great deal of its pretensions to scientific rigor and so on. But anyway, let's leave that aside. There is something religious about sex. And the third thing about Hayek is he had a very interesting and revealing argument with Keynes in 1944. Hayek had just written The Road to Serfdom, and Keynes was traveling across the United States to join the Bretton Woods stuff, and he wrote Hayek a letter. And that letter should be very, very well known, because he says to Hayek, look, I agree with you completely on your moral and political values. We are liberals. The question is your policy or my policy more likely to lead to serfdom? And that is, of course, the great issue posed. Because Keynes says, look, you say my policy is the thin end of the wedge to totalitarianism, but I say that if people follow your policy, there'll be such a revolt against it that will actually produce the serfdom. So
they tested this in Germany in the early 30s, didn't they?
Yeah, I think so. Actually, Keynes says, look, Hayek, if you follow Hayek, you get fascism. Really, in the end, because people will find it intolerable to do the things you're recommending. So that's a good debate. I always wish Keynes had somehow lived a year or two longer to be able to write a proper reply to The Road to Serfdom, because Hayek was wrong. I mean, Keynes in social democracy never led to totalitarianism at all. In fact, it was a very great, it insulated Western economies from the appeal of communism.
It's remarkable, if you read the more recent editions of The Road to Serfdom, printed by the University of Chicago Press, I'm sure everyone will be surprised to hear that. The introductions are very interesting historically, but then they have to grapple with, like, well, okay, so the United States did the New Deal, but it never actually did become fascist, so what do we have to say here about this book from 1944? It just seems historically to be relevant, but it clearly has not. It has not prevented many people from being Hayekians.
Yeah, well, of course there is a creep. I mean, if in fact you get the state eventually creeping into ownership of most of the productive assets and suppressing the market sufficiently so that everything has to be planned in order to make anything work. I'm not saying you get to totalitarianism, but you get to collectivism, and you get to something like communism. And one of the things that did happen in the Scandinavian countries in the 70s was the state was actually spending 70% of the national income at one time. And that, I think most people would regard a line there was, you had to treat somehow. Or the free enterprise system wouldn't be stifled. So I don't know it's rather like, you know, all these new introductions to Karl Marx, Communist Manifesto. There have been many editions, and each introduction has a slightly different slant. And again, it's something to do with why Marx's prophecies were never fulfilled. So we had to find some explanation. Paul Krugman wrote an introduction to a new edition of Keynes's General Theory in 2003, and they're reissuing it with Krugman's introduction. But rather cunningly, they asked me to write an afterword, which I then did. And basically what I said was, Krugman has written a completely brilliant introduction, which misses the whole point of the general theory. Well, Krugman was then shown this, and he said, well, that's fine, we'll go ahead with that. But, you know, we really ought to debate this seriously. So if my afterword in any way is able to prompt Krugman to reconsider his interpretation of the general theory, which of course that the whole introduction never mentions uncertainty one as a theory. It's just not there. And it's purely he just sets up a sort of basic model showing under employment equilibrium is possible. He thinks that's the point of the general theory. That is enough to justify government intervention.
I want to talk about math, because is everybody here familiar with the Reinhardt-Rogoff debacle a few years ago?
Which one?
Reinhardt-Rogoff.
So a few years ago, famous authors, very well respected for the quality of their research and the accuracy of their predictions. Yeah.
Yes. So two very bad economists wrote a book, and the book was designed that Paul Ryan was going around citing this book and the arguments in the book, saying that if a country gets to 90% of GDP, the public debt is 90% of GDP, they're headed for a debt crisis, and the world's about to end, the sky's going to fall. And this is, I think, everybody in this room absurd on its face, but people took this very seriously. Integral part of the policy debate for about a year. And then a graduate student looked into the data in the book, tried to replicate it, and found that Reinhardt and Rogoff had in fact just made some very basic errors in Microsoft Excel. And so it turns out that this ridiculous thesis was not actually backed up by the data. It just wasn't true. It struck me at that moment that I just couldn't tell if we had too much math in economics or not enough. Because on one hand, there's that saying, well, we found the magic number at which point the world ends, which seemed very silly to me. But then people were not actually, you know, it took a graduate student years after this was published to actually check the data. So nobody was doing, even the economics profession was bothering to check the work. Do you have thoughts on this?
Yeah, one could spend hours talking about this. I don't think it was spreadsheet errors that was the worst thing about Reinhardt and Rogoff. Anyone can make those, and of course they're ideologically slanted. You make the kind of errors that tend to support your thesis. So does Piketty, and many others do. But the real error was a logical error, which was mistaking a correlation for a cause. And it's elementary mistake in logic against which people are warned the whole time. The fact that you have a correlation doesn't establish a causal direction. But they found there was some correlation between high debt levels, very high debt GDP ratio levels, and periods of slow growth. They never considered the possibility that it was the slow growth that was causing the debt-GDP ratios to rise. They started just from the assumption that the causes ran one way. And now, why is that? I mean, I don't think the maths doesn't save you here. I mean, I think econometrics is weak. It doesn't actually deliver what it promises. It has never, to my mind, settled any arguments in theory. I think the early generation of rational expectation theories were quite right when they said we should aim for logical consistency first. And they weren't too interested in econometrics. You know, later theorists, of course, they started demanding empirically grounded sets of propositions. But I think is there too much math? Yes, of course there's too much math, because maths is often used to disguise logical weaknesses that would come out if they weren't being disguised by math, and also to make too precise things which are necessarily imprecise, and therefore give you a feeling of certainty about things which are really uncertain. Now, it's not the new generation of economists that became hooked on maths. It was the Keynesians. I mean, they started the mathematization of economics, a serious mathematization of economics, in an attempt to make it scientific, and that was Paul Samuelson. He was the person who really mathematicized Keynesian theory. Keynes had always been inclined to leave it a little loose. He always said, statistics are excellent, we need statistics. He never used graphs, because he said, I want the raw numbers always to see what's going on in the graphs. He was very skeptical of econometrics, as he said, parameters are never stable long enough in order to, establish truth of proposition. He was very opposed to these attempts to provide empirical proof of the quantity theory of money, because he said there's a cause correlation problem in this. So I think he was, if Keynes had a methodological habit or rule, I think he tried to base his models on what were called stylized facts. So that was what he relied on to give them a sort of a realism, a grasp on reality. And then he'd work them out logically and see how the variables were related to each other in the model. But I think that was his a typical stylized fact, and it can let you down, is the consumption function, Keynes' consumption function. He just said, look, this is what experience tells us to be the case, that on the whole, people save a stable fraction of their incomes, and it doesn't vary very much, doesn't it? But then, of course, it turned out that your stylized facts started to go wrong. You need a new stylized fact.
It's interesting the degree to which he's just sort of this all-purpose intellectual in the 20s and 30s. In the years since, people, conservatives attack him and say that he's, basically Karl Marx and Joseph Stalin in one package. Paul Krugman says, no, he's just built them, don't worry. It's remarkable reading your book and going through his papers at King's. One of his real heroes is Edmund Burke. Can you talk a little bit about the Burkean influence on Keynes?
Yeah, because Burke was one of those people who emphasized the uncertainty of the effects of action. And Keynes quotes Burke this should have been up on Bush's, on the wall on Bush's, behind Bush's desk, when he went into Iraq. And Keynes said, you should not only have some assurance that your intervention will make things better, but will make things sufficiently better to overcome the evil consequences of the transition. So, your intervention must not just be you're going to improve things in the short run, but that the costs are not going to be greater than the benefits that will eventually come to. So he was very, very cautious. I mean, he believed in prudence. Prudence was his guide. And I think prudence was also his guide in economic affairs. He says it is a terrible mistake to sacrifice the present generation for benefits that the future generation might get from your policy. So that's the accusation that he was always a short run person, and you know, he's got some confirmation about that when he says in the long run we're all dead. But it's not that. He didn't believe in a long run that was separable from a short set of short run things. So what happens in the short run actually determines the shape of the long run. It's not that you can do certain things now and then just think that in the long run you're going to get a better situation because the short run infects the long run. So I think prudence is very much important in Keynes' statement. He was also philosophically trained. I mean, this is what I urge in economics, that people who do economics courses, economic students, are exposed to philosophy. They should be exposed to other things. Keynes was an all-purpose intellectual, and no one can be as good at many things as Keynes was. But you should have some basic understanding, some ability to have a conversation with a philosopher about those things you are assuming to be scientifically proven.
So how do we get this guy who's really into Edinburgh being the sort of forefather of this conference, where, you know, lunch today we had a guy talking about lighting piles of money literally on fire. Where is this sort of radical left-wing stuff coming from?
Well, the thing is, of course, Burke and Keynes also said that about Burke that he was too eager to defend the outposts of a system rather than concentrate on defending its core values. So a lot of his conservatism was too extreme. I mean, that would be his criticism of Burke. But how do you get from Burke to burning money, from B to B? Was Keynes a radical? Was he a conservative? I think he was. I think probably the best way of characterizing him was he was sort of liberal paternalist, really. I mean, he minded terribly that the reigning economic orthodoxies were inflicting avoidable damage on millions and millions of people. In fact, wiping out the prospects of a whole generation. And that made him very, very angry, morally angry, fiercely angry. And he was determined to do anything he could to improve the lot of his generation and their children, but not, all further generations in the future. He was very, very, he was made indignant about rewards given by the system that had no relation to effort or contribution. In other words, people being paid more than they were worth. And he thought that was true of most bankers and people in the city. And so he would have liked much more equitable distribution of income, which he thought would also be good for the macroeconomy, by the way. You know, more even, the stronger the consumption base, the less volatile an economy would be. I mean, that he also believed. But he believed in very, very high wealth taxes against, to prevent the accumulation of usury, as he called it. Accumulation of usury.
It's in the general theory. When Randy this morning was saying, why should we tax the rich? Because they're too rich. End of story. that wasn't just like a nice quip. Like that's kind of the argument in the general theory at one point. He doesn't talk about taxes directly very much in that book, but he says, well, you know, high levels of inequality are socially bad, so if we tax the rich, well, they won't be as rich.
Yeah, but they won't be as rich, and the economy will be more stable, and also our moral requirements would be more satisfied. You remember, I mean, I don't know whether anyone remembers the concluding chapter of the general theory. He says there are two big faults in modern society. One is you can't secure full employment, and the other is the inequitable distribution of wealth and income. He says, I'm going to deal with the first, but there is an agenda for the second. And you need to link up the dots in a way. And I think the political system or regime that really operated in the 50s and 60s was a combination of Keynes and social democracy. I mean, you could call it Keynes and social democracy. I mean, that was, I'm talking more about Europe and the United States, but certainly the great society programs of the 60s. There was a lot of attempts to redress. Then that was all abandoned. Distribution is no longer a question for mainstream economics. Everyone is, what, paid what they're worth in a free market. They all get their marginal products, don't they? And so you don't have a distribution issue unless there's some element of monopoly somewhere and that's not an perfection. It's at that level.
So Keynes didn't get famous for writing the general theory. In a lot of ways, this is his most controversial book during his lifetime. He got famous for the economic consequences of the piece. And this is probably an unpopular opinion in this crowd, but that's my favorite Keynes book by a long shot.
It's his shortest.
And you can skip a lot of the tables because the statistics aren't relevant anymore. Are there ideas in that book that you see carrying through, you know, through his thinking into the general theory that are relevant to his later economic work?
Yeah, well, of course, again, you know, the unknowability of the future. He says, I mean, for example, he says, let's add up. Let's look at the pre-war. German exports and pre-war German imports. And we'll see then, assuming you know, that this sort of continues, that Germany won't be able to afford, it won't be able to generate what we now call a primary surplus sufficient to make the reparations payments that are being demanded by the Allies. That is the economic core. Then he says, of course it is true that it may be the case that productivity improvements will happen and this will happen and there'll be other changes in the world which will make it possible for Germany in the future to pay these sums of money. But he says, that's no excuse for talking nonsense. We don't know, but what we do know is it can't pay these sums which have to start being paid next year and the year after and the year after that. And if we try to do that, if we try to force them to do that, then he says, I dare say vengeance will not limp. So that's an application of his probability theory and the uncertainty theory to a very concrete problem. So it's a great book, and again, there's a lot of moral indignation behind it. In fact, the first edition was sunk because it was printed in Glasgow and the ship carried it went to the bottom of the North Sea, but very few of them survived because there was another ship which didn't sink. And I've got one of those. It's a very valuable, it's very rare. Then they printed lots of others which had first edition of them, but you can tell which are the survivors of the ship and which actually were printed elsewhere.
You should see his books, they're really thick if you haven't. There's a lot of detail on the history of Keynesian writings in these.
Why is Economic Consequences of the Peace your favorite book?
It makes very explicit the connection between the political world and the economic world. and his fear over what's going to happen to Germany is not a fear over abstractions about statistics. It's a fear about what's going to happen to people's lives, how they're going to live, and how they're going to be governed. And I think a lot of the economics profession today tends to intentionally, I think, often disconnect itself from the actual sort of full-blooded consequences of what it's talking about. It's much safer to talk about productivity and costs rather than communities that are being destroyed.
Yeah, and why is it that Germans never read the economic consequences of the peace today? insist on presenting these huge bills to countries which they know are never going to be paid, at the cost of souring, the construction that they're actually committed to.
Yeah. There's also a lot in that. That book is an exercise in political accountability itself. He's really, those of you who haven't read it, there's four very, didn't include all of them, but there's some very vivid character sketches of the leaders of the time. In Keynes, we're completely botching the negotiations surrounding the Treaty of Versailles. And he really lets them have it. He believes that they've done something really, really terrible. And I don't think we really hold our political leaders in the United States economically accountable anymore, at least in the press. There's a sense of which, if bad things happen, well, nothing can be done, or that's just the way the world is, not the bad things or the outcome of bad policies.
Yeah, I mean, if an economist today wrote a book, maybe that book has been called The Economic Consequences of the Iraq War, would it start with character sketches of Bush, of Colin Powell, of Rumsfeld, and in their strengths and their weaknesses? I'm just thinking of an economist writing. What economist can you think of who might have Nordhaus or someone writing a book about this sort of topic? See, they wouldn't do it, I don't think. There would be lots of tables and maybe the odd equation or two, but it wouldn't start with that, and it wouldn't start also with the insightful introduction where he sketches the unstable foundations of pre-1914 Europe, how the terms of trade were slowly turning against it, how the system depended on the psychological balance between the rich and the poor, so that the rich were able, in the way he then talked about it, to keep their wealth on condition that they didn't spend it, and the threat to their position would arise when they became spendthrifts started flaunting their riches in the face of others. All that is sort of the psychology of it is brilliant. And what annoys me about Paul's account, Krugman's treatment of the general theory, is he completely ignores chapter 12, which is where it is. That's the chapter called The State of Long-Term Expectation, where Keynes draws again a picture of the psychology of the capitalist system, of the investing class, and how they were, in that the phrase animal spirits occurs. But of course, I think he made too much of that phrase, because it's interpreted as Keynes has accepted that a lot of investment behavior is irrational. And I don't think that's the way Keynes looked upon it. It's irrational if you ignore uncertainty. If you take uncertainty into account, a lot of these behaviors are reasonable ways of behaving when you don't know the future. And when the pretense to knowledge breaks down, you then get panic, chaos, herds rush to the exit. I mean, all that he understood, but In most accounts of the general theory, except those Keynesian accounts, really, and no doubt new monetary theory accounts, that chapter is ignored. It's regarded as not scientific, but, you know, to do with nasty things like psychology. Now, of course, they're more interested in psychology, but they, again, can't, I mean, they're the behavioral economists, a lot of them, at any rate, they tend to say or believe that decision-making behaviors that don't conform to the neoclassical optimizing model of decision-making are irrational. That's not true.
There's a wonderful clip from about February, I think it's at Davos, Jamie Dimon talking to somebody from CNBC, and they're talking about the big rise in the stock market after Trump's election. And Jamie Dimon says, you know, it looks like Trump's election has unleashed the animal spirits. This is very wonderful. And it just doesn't mean anything. They're just talking nonsense to each other in the Keynesian sense.
Yeah, and no one, I once read a very, very good analysis, and I've forgotten really actually about what animal spirits mean. And why they're called animal, and why they're called spirits, and it's a term from biology or zoology. I mean, it has a definite meaning in relation to the animal world, which of course is quite the opposite of irrational. I mean, you can't think of really irrational animal behaviour as in the way you might be able to think of irrational human behaviour. But the point is, Keynes doesn't interpret animal spirits as irrational. And I think that people who have written about this, particularly I'm thinking of Schiller and Apollon, and they tend to interpret it as irrational. And I don't think that's right. And I think Kahneman and Tversky, they also tend to believe that it's associated with the irrational types of decision making, which may be effective, but not the calculated.
Well, we've been going for a little over an hour now. Before we wrap things up, I just sort of want to get your general view of where you see, this is an MMT campus after all, where you see MMT fitting into this broader sort of Keynesian heritage that's been going for almost a century now.
Well, I think MMC has a great potential of breathing new life into macroeconomics. I mean, to make of macroeconomics the central focus of economic study, and to dethrone microeconomics. I mean, it seems to me that is where it's going to make a huge contribution. I was, I think Jamie Galbraith got it absolutely right in his speech yesterday, when he said, really, macroeconomics was regarded as an almost illegitimate child of microeconomics, and still is. Yes, you need some macroeconomics because, markets have certain imperfections, and therefore, and you can't quite do a Hayek on the system because that would be suicide. So you need macroeconomic policy of a limited, slimmed-down kind. But they want to eject it as much as possible, and they want to limit its scope so that the glories of microeconomic analysis can shine more brightly. And so they're wedded to the view that, in other words, they reject Keynes's idea that the whole is not the sum of its parts. They reject the fallacy of composition. They reject all those sort of, they're called different things now, but they reject these central Keynesian insights. And I think the point about modern monetary theory is that any extra power it gives to macroeconomics is just a huge plus.
Like
I'm not sufficiently under the skin of modern monetary theory to know whether it's going to do its job. I hope it will.
Right,
I'm sure it's a positive. I mean, I can already, even in the work I do, I can see where modern monetary theory could end some of the muddles in macroeconomics that now exist, the muddles about money
and the role of money and where money comes from and what money is and all that. And all that is very, very, very encouraging. So I would say more power to your elbow, more conferences like this, more people coming to them, more publications, publications in good quality journals, so that one can start influencing the mainstream and getting into mainstream departments if one can, and really securing the survival of economics. Because I think that if this movement fails and economics continues along, you know, a path which was sketched out before the crash, I think it'll disappear in some. I mean, it's living off capital. The diminishing returns has set in. More people are going to look for other sorts of inspiration. In terms of the grand design, economics will always be useful for many, many purposes. Economics, exactly as it's done today, will be useful for many purposes. But it won't give us an idea, really, of how the world works in the round and what we ought to do in terms of grand policy. We won't have anything to say about that, and therefore others will take its place. So anyway, I mean, that. So I'd start with macroeconomics always. And there's a new textbook, I know, about to be published, we just start the study of economics with macro, and that's how it will turn.
All right, well, thank you so much for joining us.